Buses are a coming, oh yes. Buses are a coming, oh yes. Buses are a coming, buses are a coming, buses are a coming, oh yes. Better get you ready. Get you ready, oh yes. Better get you ready, better get you ready, better get you ready, oh yes. Buses are a-coming, oh yes. Buses are a-coming, oh yes. Buses are a-coming, buses are a-coming, buses are a-coming, oh yes. Coming to Alabama, oh yes. Coming through Alabama, oh yes. Coming through Alabama, coming through Alabama. Buses are a-coming, oh yes. Buses are a-coming, oh yes. Buses are a-coming, buses are a-coming, buses are a-coming, oh yes. They're rolling into Jackson, oh yes. Rolling Jackson, oh yes, rolling in the Jackson, rolling in the Jackson, buses are a-coming, oh yes.
Good evening. My name is Paris Miller Fushi, and on behalf of the Orange County Community Remembrance Coalition and our partner Carolina K through 12, I would like to welcome you to tonight's commemoration of the 60th anniversary of the Freedom Rides. OCCRC is an alliance of organizations and individuals coming together for a common cause with common goals and desired outcomes. Our work is to disrupt and overcome the detrimental systems and mindsets that have plagued America for generations, and to help usher forth a future of humanity, equity, and justice for all of us. We begin tonight's program with Eagle Pride, and my fellow North Carolina Central University alum, preeminent scholar, Dr. Freddie Parker. Dr. Parker is currently Professor Emeritus and former Julius L. Chambers Endowed Professor of History at North Carolina Central University in Durham, North Carolina. He taught history at NCCU for 39 years. In 2008, Dr. Parker was appointed by Governor Mike Easley to the then newly created African American Heritage Commission. And on January 31st, 2020, Dr. Parker was honored by Governor Roy Cooper for his exemplary service and invaluable contributions made to North Carolina's community and education culture. Welcome, Dr. Freddie Parker.
Thank you, Paris, and good evening to everyone. It is great to be with you this evening as we commemorate the 60th anniversary of the Freedom Rides and salute those brave women and men who sometimes gave their lives to wipe clean the festering racism that continues to plague us as late as May 5th, 2021. The fact that we are here 60 years later is a testimony to the significance of the Freedom Riders and their journey to end racial discrimination. It was the Freedom Rides that catapulted Robert Williams of Monroe, North Carolina, to national and international fame in 1961 when he was forced to leave the United States and find refuge in Cuba and China. This evening, I would like to provide an overview of the Black struggle for freedom in our area. Chapel Hill, Carrboro, Durham, and Hillsboro over the decades. The civil rights movement began the moment slavery ended in the United States. The struggle to achieve first-class citizenship for the 4.5 million Blacks who lived in the United States in 1865 was even an ongoing movement by free Blacks during slavery. That movement simply continued through the Reconstruction and post-Reconstruction periods into the 20th century. By 1910, Blacks had established dozens of organizations and institutions to fight voter suppression, lynching, Jim Crow legislation, and overall racial discrimination and terror. These organizations included the Afro-American Council, founded in 1890, the Afro-American League, founded in 1897, the Niagara Movement of 1905, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, 1910, the Urban League in 1910. Additionally, hundreds of organizations and institutions were founded by Blacks at the local level to confront the inequality, the injustices, and economic disparities so apparent in Black communities across this country, and especially in the South. The Black church, as well as cultural organizations and fraternal societies, were established to help fulfill the needs of more than 9 million people who surely could not rely on the federal and state governments. Black Americans learned at the end of Reconstruction that Black solidarity and self-help were the keys to their survival in the United States. By 1890, it was also clear in the Black community that economic development was necessary for their survival, and thus the emergence of Black businesses throughout the country. In 1900, there were 20,000 Black-owned businesses in the United States. By 1914, that number doubled to 40,000. John Merrick, Charles Clinton Spalding, and Aaron McDuffie Moore were Black business leaders in Durham, North Carolina. They established the North Carolina Mutual Life Insurance Company, Mechanics and Farmers Bank, barbershops, a real estate company, and other businesses in the city. To bolster Black economic development, Booker T. Washington founded the National Negro Business League in 1900. Chapters of the league were set up in at least 30 states by 1915, and at least 15 chapters were established in North Carolina. The ongoing civil rights movement led by Black men and women existed across the United States, including Durham and Orange counties, North Carolina. These activities were most evident in Durham beginning in the 1920s and continuing to the present. Louis Austin used his newspaper, the Carolina Times, as a weapon in the civil rights struggle from the time of its founding in 1927. Articles devoted to ending segregation, the need to boycott white establishments, and the importance of using the courts to advance the civil rights struggle could be found in Austin's Carolina Times. Beginning in the 1930s, Blacks in Durham, in collusion with the NAACP, sought to end segregation in higher education. In 1933, Thomas Hocutt, a North Carolina College for Negroes, now North Carolina Central University student, applied to the pharmacy school at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. He was denied admission because he was Black. Conrad Pearson, Cecil McCoy, and William Hastie served as Hocutt's attorneys. This was the first court case to seek to bring an end to higher education, to desegregate higher education in the United States. Unfortunately for Hocutt, and those who fought to end segregation in higher education, Dr. James E. Shepherd, who was the president of North Carolina College for Negroes at the time, had refused to send Hocut's transcript to the registrar at the University of North Carolina. Though a loss for Hocut, the case served as a catalyst for future litigation that ultimately ended segregation in higher education. In 1935, influential Black leaders in Durham founded the Durham Committee on Negro Affairs. Now it's called the Durham Committee on the Affairs of Black People. Among its founders were Lewis Austin, James E. Shepherd, Charles Clinton Spaulding, and Rencher N. Harris. The Durham Committee's primary objective was to register Blacks to vote and to support candidates who would best serve the interests of the Black community. In October 1942, the Southern Conference on Race Relations met in Durham at North Carolina College for Negroes. Leaders such as Charlotte Hawkins Brown, Gordon Hancock, Luther P. Jackson, P.B. Young, and James E. Shepherd were among the 57 attendees. Conferees addressed many of the major problems facing the Black community. The result of the meeting was the publication of a document in December 1942 known as the Durham Manifesto. The manifesto addressed the right of Blacks to vote, abolition of the poll tax, an end to the white primary, an end to police brutality in the Black community, an end to police brutality in the Black community, passage of anti-lynching legislation, social security benefits for service and farm workers, and other necessary reforms Blacks had fought to secure. Durham County became a hub for civil rights activity from the 1930s until now. On June 23rd, 1957, a group of protesters led by Reverend Douglas Moore sought to desegregate the Royal Ice Cream Company in Durham. The protesters were arrested in this sit-ins demonstration that served as a forerunner for similar acts of protest throughout the South, including the Greensboro sit-ins that took place at Woolworth's in February 1960. The protesters, known as the Royal Seven, were found guilty in every court to which they appealed. The United States Supreme Court refused to hear the case. Demonstrations and protests to end segregation in schools and places of public accommodation in Durham County continued during the 1960s and 1970s. The Black struggle for greater access to the ballot and end to segregation in all sectors of society eventually led to Black elected officials serving on the Board of Education, County Commission, City Council, and in 1989, Chester Jenkins became the first Black mayor of Durham. Blacks in Orange County fought similar battles to gain access to the ballot, to end segregation of schools, in transportation, and other places of public accommodation. The Congress of Racial Equality Corps was founded in 1942 in Chicago by Bayard Rustin, James Farmer, and other civil rights workers to, quote, bring about equality for all people, regardless of race, creed, sex, age, disability, sexual orientation, religion, or ethnic background, end of quote. In 1947, members of the organization set out to test a 1946 ruling by the United States Supreme Court that segregation on buses and trains was unconstitutional. Black and white members boarded trailways and Greyhound buses and traveled across the South on what they called a journey of reconciliation. One journey brought them to Chapel Hill, North Carolina, where four members were arrested. They returned to Hillsborough for sentencing in 1949 and were given prison terms in segregated chain gangs. These freedom riders inspired those who took up the challenge in 1961 and rolled through the South. In 1951, the United States Supreme Court case, McKissick versus Carmichael, moved legal barriers to admission of African Americans to the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill Law School. The court ruling also opened the doors for Blacks to attend the university's medical school. By 1955, Black undergraduate students attended UNC Chapel Hill. Admission did not mean acceptance, of course, by other students, faculty, and administrators. Students faced hostility, intimidation, and discrimination by whites. Sit-in demonstrations by North Carolina A&T State University students on February 1st, 1960, at Woolworths inspired protests throughout the South. A group of Black Chapel Hill High School students were inspired by the sit-ins in Greensboro and decided to stage their own at the Colonial Drugstore. Their actions on February 28, 1960, led to other protests during the summer of 1960 and the arrest of several protesters. The Lincoln High School students who led the demonstrations were referred to as the Chapel Hill Nine. Demonstrations to end segregation continued in Chapel Hill in 1963 and 1964. Efforts to desegregate downtown businesses resulted in the arrest of more than 1,000 protesters. Not only were demonstrators met with stiff opposition by police, but store owners poured bleach and ammonia on these brave men and women who sought nothing but first-class citizenship. Their persistence led to an end to segregated facilities in Chapel Hill, and later the Civil Rights Bill passed in 1964, on paper at least, began the process of desegregation in the United States. A cafeteria workers' strike at UNC in 1969 was part of the struggle for decent wages and better working conditions. The first strike began in February and ended in March with a raise for employees and managerial training for some employees. Another strike was necessary in November of the same year after the university outsourced all cafeteria operations to Saga, a food service company. That strike ended after a few weeks with few positive changes taking place for cafeteria workers. Orange County schools, including those in Hillsborough, Cedar Grove, Eflin, and Chapel Hill, were under constant threat by civil rights leaders to end segregation. Protests by Lincoln High School students in Chapel Hill and Central High School students in Hillsborough in 1968 eventually led to desegregation of public schools in Orange County. Blacks and whites joined forces in Hillsborough from the decade of the 1960s to boycott businesses and to desegregate organizations and institutions. Chapel Hill elected Howard Lee as its first Black mayor in 1969. In 1989, Hillsborough elected Horace Johnson as its first Black mayor. Blacks were elected to town and county commissions and boards of education in Orange County as early as the 1960s and 1970s, and that tradition continues today. The struggle for civil and human rights is an ongoing one which requires continued fortitude, determination, but most of all, a desire to want an equal and just treatment of all people, regardless of race, ethnicity, gender, religion, or class. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Parker, for laying the groundwork and context for our panel one discussion. And at this time, I'd like to introduce our first panel and featured guest speaker, who was among the fearless and determined freedom writers, Mr. David Dennis. Mr. Dennis was on the first Freedom bus ride from Montgomery, Alabama to Jackson, Mississippi in 1961. He served as the co-director of the Council of Federated Organizations, COFO. He was the Mississippi director of the Congress of Racial Equality, CORE, and the coordinator of the Mississippi Freedom Summer. Mr. Dennis has gone on to work with Bob Moses as the director of the Southern Initiative of the Algebra Project, promoting quality education as the key to civil rights in the 21st century. Professor William Sturkey will be joining Mr. Dennis later in the discussion. Professor Sturkey is a historian of the post-1865 United States who specializes in the history of race in the American South. His first book, To Write in the Light of Freedom, is a co-edited collection of newspapers, essays, and poems produced by African American Freedom School students during the Mississippi Freedom Summer of 1964. Dr. Sturkey is currently working on a biography of the legendary Vietnam War hero, Master Sergeant Roy Benavidez. And our interviewers for the first panel are three amazing young activists, UNC student Derek Davis, and two Chapel Hill Carborough NAACP Youth Council members, Joya Horton and Natasha Jetter. Let's begin.
Hey, Mr. Dennis, thank you for taking the time to join us. So I have the first question, and I just wanted to ask, would you share a little about the origins of the Freedom Rides? For example, we know the Morgan versus Virginia case and other events that took place, but what kind of similar events also may have caused the rides?
I think that my discussions with Jim Farm and others in the beginning of the Freedom Rides, it had a lot to do with the fact the cases that had been decided, but at the same time, is especially in the Deep South, there's no real adherence to the laws of the court cases. And that is that we still had the segregation of the bus stations and buses going interstate. So it's very interesting in tracing the history. I mean, the Morgan case brought into a different type of issue around Interstate Commerce Commission. It was not about the what most cases have been during that time is the 14th Amendment Equal Protection Clause. And so that violation of the Constitution had established that you could not segregate crossing state lines on public transportation. The South had gotten around that is by saying that within the states, they had the privacy laws. So they stepped in, kept into practice, though Plessy v. Ferguson, separate but equal. So the Morgan case, in one sense, it sort of brought that to light, but at the same time, it did not dismiss that part of the cases. So the issue around segregation still remained the same and within the states, and also private bus lines and privacy acts. And so that was one of the problems we had here. So that was what sort of was part of the inspiration. And then you had the what came after that is the Keyes case and others and the Henderson case. So even with those two cases that came later, there still was the reports of the practice in the South of segregation. And so the idea was to challenge and put the pressure on the federal government to enforce the laws of the Constitution and the 14th Amendment and in the State Commerce Commission.
The second question that we have for you is, what commonalities did you observe about the communities that you visited in the South?
Well, I'm from the South, okay. That was one thing about it. I was from Shreveport, Louisiana, which is one of the most segregated places in the country as part of the Black Belt issue. I was also born on a plantation and lived as a sharecropper with a sharecropper family until I was 9 years of age. So until that particular time is segregation, of course, was like a way of life and everything else. And so it wasn't that my second time. At one time I'd gone out of the state of Louisiana when I was around 12 years old. And the second time I went outside of the state of Louisiana was to join the Freedom Rides. So I had my introduction to what was going on in other places. It was one common ground of segregation, although there have been different parts of the state of Louisiana. I was raised and all during this period of time is I sat in the back of the bus. I remember going to school. I got up in the morning, got on the bus, rode in the back of the bus and went to school. And one of the first things we did at the school was to pledge allegiance to the flag and to everybody else is there. And then I have to leave the next in the evenings and go back and get on a bus and go and sit in the back of that bus. So those are the things that really burned in my head is, so that what's the commonality there was that it never stopped and never changed. Going into Montgomery, Alabama to join the Freedom Rides, what I found there was a lot of violence and enforcement of segregation there, but it's no different than what it was in other places. And so being arrested was expected, and I would have been arrested by sitting on the wrong section of the buses, couldn't eat at the lunch counters, anything else in Louisiana at all. So really and truly is, it was segregation at that time was really across the board, you know, so there's no difference, no change. So I'd never had the experience. My first time going up north and having that experience was with Corps in the summer of 1961. I had never been outside the South until that time is. And at this time I was 20 years of age. Now I found that to be very different. And to be honest with you, I was pretty scared about it. And so the language was different. You know, I mean, one of the things, the joke is about it, was to give you how green I was. So I was staying at a place called the Sloan House, which is right on 34th Street. And so in the evenings, it's a YMCA. And so I would go in the evenings because go all these movie theaters on 42nd Street and all these lights and stuff, you know, really. You know, and so one evening on my way to the Sloan House, this white guy comes up to me and he says, where are you going? I said, right down the street. He says, all right, if I walk with you. So I said, okay, you know, I mean, to me, hey, friendly guy. So I thought he was friendly. And so he walks, we walked to down close to his home. He said, before I go any further, I need to know something. I said, well, he said, are you gay? So my response to him was, as often as I can be. Well, I didn't understand the language, right? I mean, because to me is in the South is being gay just been a very happy guy, you know, to do but sexual orientation what they have is. And so the next day when I went and told people what this is all about is, you know, they just cracked up laughing at me by the fact that I didn't know, but the language is different, lifestyles are different, and being able to be around people on an equal basis was totally out of whack with me. I mean, that was just a totally new experience.
Thank you, Mr. Dennis. Bayard Rustin was on the journey of reconciliation in 1947, and here in North Carolina, Syracuse challenged the segregation losses in 1955. Would you talk about the connection to the Freedom Rides that you participated in?
Yeah, well, she was more or less, in terms of that child, the Syracuse case was a very important case. It happened right before the Brown versus Board of Education, right during that same period of time is. And so the whole question there is, went to the issue of the privacy piece that I talked about a little bit earlier, basis. So, I guess the idea there was the challenge to the right to be able to sit in the place you wanted to in terms of travel. So it went to the heart of the question of Plessy v. Ferguson cases. It really closed the loophole of privacy interstate travel and also interstate travel. So therefore, it went to attack the heart of segregation is in public transportation in the country. And so it went to the heart also of really the Plessy v. Ferguson case of separate but equal. So it really went after the whole statewide thing. So it was a far-reaching case. It didn't get the publicity it should have, because you had right after that, you had Brown versus Board of Education and other acts and a lot of activities around civil rights and stuff like this. But I think that the Keyes case was extremely important in terms of opening doors is giving a more openness to terms of the challenge to segregation in public places. So it was a very, very important case on the Keyes. And she was, what made it very interesting though, is in this country is, I mean, she was in the military, you know? And so she was made to move a seat for another military guy, white guy, to have her seat, you know, both serving this country, what we have is. And the other piece that happened is, along those lines, I'm just leave it there in terms of its importance to us pieces. So in terms of the similarities, what we have is, in terms of what we were challenging and later on is, it became the foundation too, is in terms of overall challenge, not just in terms of interstate travel, but in public transportation is, but in terms of public accommodations too. So it was a far reaching case as far as I'm concerned.
Okay, thank you for that response. My question is, what role did HBCUs play in the Freedom Rides and the overall movement? What do you observe about the role that HBCUs are currently playing in the movement today?
Well, HBCUs has been very important in terms of the movement and challenging segregation is and producing Black people who could be able to become first-class citizens, but also in terms of being able to demonstrate the fact is that they are just as smart as anybody else's. So they have to break barriers along the way in terms of training and not only providing that education to people who are able to challenge the laws of segregation in this country. So the HBCUs have been all important to us. In fact, they provided an education that white institutions could not provide then, and white institutions cannot provide now to Black kids, as far as I'm concerned. So the importance to the movement is, I mean, most of the civil rights leaders you have and the demonstrations you had came were initiated through the HBCUs, and especially when you got into the 60s. So their move and their importance roles, I mean, in producing leaders in this country, Black leaders in the country, has been extraordinary. And that is the reason why they're under such attack now is, and how the country has moved, what Bob Moses calls a surge back. When you look at this whole tie it all together, and the importance of where we're talking about voter suppression and what we have is, every time that this Blacks be able to make a move forward, the laws have changed and implemented in such a way and interpreted in such a way as to push us back, a surge back. So when we talk about 1872, the Civil Rights Act of 1872 is, which outlawed the Klan. And not only that is, but considered the Klan was a terrorist organization in this country, even back over then. What only took 11, 12 years later, you know, when the Supreme Court, you know, overturned all of this, all right, just took it away pieces. And so, that tells the importance of what is happening is in terms of the Supreme Court now where we are is, and what can happen is in peace and what happened even in terms of erosion of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. So you begin to look at all these cases and what has happened since then, I mean, these surge back is important to look at. The Civil Rights Act of 1964 was a very important step. But at the same time is this country, the people in control, because remember, as far as I'm concerned, the laws in this country are made by those in power and they are to protect those in power. So in 1964, when after the Civil Rights Act was passed and 1965 Voting Rights Act was passed, the people in power began to immediately to take action to try to close what I call the loopholes, and probably also the 1964 Civil Rights Act as being the Trojan horse of the civil rights movement, since it, because what they attached to was different laws and policies that killed the movement. So the first thing you had was in 1964 is what the strength of the Black community, when you talk about HBCUs and others, had to do with the fact is of our extended family, our able to close tight communities, our being able to work and live together, and our sharing of ourselves and life and with each other. What happened there was first you had the Monaghan report, right? That blamed Black people for segregation, or the impact of segregation. And I'll start out with the fact is saying the fact is that condemning the fact is that Black people coming from single parent homes, you know, that you came from a single parent home, that was the major problem. Disregarding the fact is that the first thing that happened when Black slaves were brought to the country is we were separated, you know, the families were. That was part of the act to try to destroy the community base. But when we came up, as we grew up, is we had instituted what we call this extended family pieces. I grew up as under single parent, but I had a lot of fathers. So I walked down the street, they called me Sonny, and people would come out, they'd say, you know, we want a cookie, Sonny. They knew if I did something right or wrong. If something went, family got into trouble, people were there to help. What helped us in the civil rights movement days in the 60s was that we had all this work we do with that, but we were taken by the community and taken in. I mean, that was the important thing to think about the Freedom Riders. The Freedom Riders was beyond just a challenge of segregation in terms of interstate commerce and travel. What it really did was that when SNCC and core people, when young people going out into Lyons County and North Carolina, and Floyd McKissick and them is, and Mississippi and other places like that, the community opened arms. I mean, we would know everybody, whether you were SNCC or CORE, they call you a Freedom Rider. So the Freedom Riders became a symbolic representation of young people fighting for freedom. So that's one of the pieces that I think we forget about the importance of the Freedom Riders in that piece is whereby it gave people hope, but only that is communities began to look and embrace young people, you know, because the fact is that freedom. So freedom movement, people involved in freedom movement became known as Freedom Riders, whether you were on a Freedom Rider or not, it didn't make any difference. But this whole family structure pieces became important, how the country began to act then to destroy the impact that the 1964 civil rights had on us as a community. The other piece you had is you experienced it right there in North Carolina, Louisiana crosses, they called it urban renewal, all right? And so what they did was to build expressways right straight through the community's economic basis. You know, so you had in North Carolina, in Raleigh is Black Wall Street, New Orleans, Claiborne Avenue, wherever the business was, if you look at the country and that history is, urban renewal went through the Black community and destroyed it. So what I'm getting at here is that even then, since they did back in the beginning of the 19th century, I mean, end of the 19th century, coming into the 20th century, and even then was how they used the laws and everything else to be able to destroy a Black advancement at that time, which you call a setback, a surgeback. So you got the same thing happening now with the change in the Supreme Court is this whole piece of this country. And the racism that's there. I mean, what the last administration did was peel back the onion and said, you know, this is what true America is all about is on that particular side is. So segregation is alive and well. But I just want to bring that out and just show how this thing sort of builds. So now you got these cases coming up in the Supreme Court, to the Supreme Court is. And so we know what kind of Supreme Court we have. So when you talk about the importance of voting, the importance of organizing and never stop organizing, we stopped organizing in 1964. We stopped organizing after Obama was elected. You see. So the Freedom Ride piece has a lot more to it than just the fact is of getting on a bus. You know, it's just a symbolic representation is of drive and what we need to, and commitment, which we need to continue, you know, throughout, you know, now, because we're right back now to as far as I'm concerned, is to where we were in 1964, 63. I took a long way to get to that.
No, I definitely appreciate that. And thank you for sharing all of that, especially like the kind of connections to today. I actually want to take this moment to introduce Professor Sturkey into this conversation and just wanted to welcome him and thank him for taking the time to join us. And a question that I wanted to pose was, what reflections do you have after listening to Mr. David Dennis? How will it impact your academic work and how does it inform movement work of today?
Hey, thank you all so much. You know, listening to Mr. Dennis, we met a couple times before Mr. Dennis. It's been years, but
yeah, you know, look familiar.
Yeah, well, hi, I guess it's good to see you. You know, one of the things that always strikes me about, you know, engaging with civil rights veteran activists like Mr. Dennis is how recent so much of this history is. And I think about the people that came before me. You know, my father was born in 1948. You know, he was a teenager before anybody that looked like me ever worked at UNC Chapel Hill, you know, and I just never forget that. You know, a lot of people want to sort of, you know, wipe our hands and say, okay, we're done with this, get over it. But, you know, it's just so recent. And there's so many people still with us. But I think the other thing that I really react to is the reason I started studying history in the first place. And, you know, I'm not just saying this because we're here right now today virtually, but when I started learning about the civil rights movement, I was in such awe because the faith that people like Mr. Dennis had, I think not only in themselves, but in our country. I mean, these are the greatest patriots in American history, in my view, but then also the courage that it took. And I think, you know, really understanding what they were up against and also how unpopular some of these things were, you know, really helps give us sort of moral guidance for our own lives today. And, you know, like they didn't know they were going to win is the most remarkable thing, or they didn't know what they were going to change, right? You know, when Gallup did a poll about the Freedom Rides in 1961, only 22% of Americans approved of the tactic of the Freedom Rides. And of course, it's one of the most legendary, you know, and audacious and courageous forms of activism we've ever seen in this country. And I just think that it is so remarkable. And it really helps motivate me to do the work that I try and do, especially with young folks, to help expose them to some of the activists of the past, because I know how powerful those stories can be in guiding our future directions.
Thank you, Professor. Can you talk about the climate of segregated travel in North Carolina in the 1950s?
Yeah, sure. And I just want to point out too that there's been a lot more attention to Black travel in the Jim Crow era in popular culture recently, you know, from like the film Green Book to the show Lovecraft Country, which I personally really enjoy. There is a brand new book out called Traveling Black by a professor named Mia Bay at the University of Pennsylvania. It just came out like a few weeks ago. And that's really interesting to me. But the thing that strikes me the most about traveling during the Jim Crow era is the stress of every interaction. You know, like you never know when something's going to go south. Black people had to carry Jim Crow because when things didn't go the way they were supposed to, African-Americans always had to carry the repercussions, right? If there was some sort of, you know, line that was crossed or somebody was offended, you know, if something went south, it was always, you know, born by African-Americans, not white people, who might have been the reason that something went south in the first place. And so that stress of every interaction, knowing that, okay, if this does not go well, you know, what could possibly happen? That sounds incredibly difficult to deal with. It's something that you really have to bear. But then also to me, you know, and just thinking about like the last road trip I took, you know, I got an Airbnb, I put my dog in a bag in my car, and I just drove to Asheville. And it was actually pretty easy to do that, you know? But like, if you're a Black person traveling in the Jim Crow South, I mean, you've got to plan out where you're going to stop, like well before time. You know, you got to maybe talk to your friends about where they stopped, you know, and if they took a similar journey beforehand. But just like the intensive planning and care that must have gone into those decisions, especially if you had children with you, you know, or any other family member, must have just been utterly exhausting. But, you know, Black folks were able to navigate it. You know, they did it. So, yeah.
Thank you for that. Can you make a connection between the journey of reconciliation in North Carolina and what impact it had in Chapel Hill, specifically focusing on the arrest of Bayard Rustin?
Yeah, you know, I wish that I could say that it had a great impact on Chapel Hill. So, of course, you know, this journey came through 1947. Several people were arrested, Bayard Rustin. And as far as I can tell, Chapel Hill didn't change all that much after that. So, I mean, like, we still had people that were still very resistant to the civil rights movement, that were still resisting desegregation. They still had to have a sit-in, 13 years later? That was, you know, contested. And, you know, as often as we like to call Chapel Hill a very liberal place, at least some people do, you know, there's still all of these battles that Black folks had to face here. I mean, just look at what it took to take down a Confederate monument, for crying out loud. And, you know, so Bayard Rustin came, got arrested, and in some other place, I think we would have loved to have seen Chapel Hill maybe a few years later say, oh my God, that was a horrible mistake. What can we do about that? But I don't think Chapel Hill has ever really come to terms with that. I think most people probably have no idea that that happened. There is a marker. I think it's just off Franklin Street, but I don't think that our town has really dealt with the history of race very well at all. And I don't know what they've really learned from Bayard Rustin.
Thank you, Professor. This last question, both Mr. Dennis and Professor Sturkey can answer. How did the youth movement in Chapel Hill mirror the national movement?
Well, I can go. Well, first, I would say that I don't know too much about the Chapel Hill movement in itself is, although I do some people from the area. And I did spend a little time there with Floyd McKissick and meetings and stuff like that. And there was a Dr. Doris Terry Williams, who was very active along those lines. But and also Tom Gaither was very active involved in the movement piece. But I was not. But in terms of, I can relate that to other areas around the country is and the impact that it had and what is happening today is. And so the movement itself is the Freedom Rides and others had, I think it really helped and motivated, especially the students coming out of the HBCUs in the country is. And it was the beginning of their feeling that there's a necessity for them to do something. And so you had your first really mass rallies. I mean, coming out of Southern University in 1960 and in 1961 was the largest, you know, 4,000 kids, students marching the streets of Baton Rouge. And so you have a lot that is encouraging on there. But one of the things is that I think that, even today, I mean, it's very interesting how the impact that the Freedom Rides have on students. So there's a group of students out of New Orleans, from Dillard, Xavier, Southern University of New Orleans and stuff. And so they've been having these sessions whereby they look at films and on the Freedom Rides, and they look at films on the voter registration suppression pieces. And then they have discussions around it, you know? So about a month or so ago, they had a discussion around the fact they wanted to do something. So they came out of that is and called and want to have a summit meeting of all the representatives from all the HBCU campuses as many as they possibly can this summer to discuss a strategy for making a demand on Congress. And they used a Freedom Ride as an example of as a model to do that. So what they want to do is have what they call a Freedom Ride for justice. So beginning in New Orleans, the busloads of kids going from city to city, and each city they go into, they stop in this, they go into visit other HBCU campuses, holding mass rallies, and ending up in DC with busloads of young people joining them on each of these stops on the way to Washington, DC. In Washington, DC, they want to have a meeting with Congress. The demand from Congress is that they do something around voter suppression, which is a very timely time is because that's going to be 2022, or you're going to have the federal elections coming up again. And on top of that is they're asking for to look at the issue around quality education as a constitutional right. which has never been declared in this country. This country has never said that you have a constitutional right to a quality education, all right? So they're making this demand. So for young people, Black kids coming out of the HBCUs, going to Washington, D.C., and that larger numbers with a plan to do that is to make this demand, that to me happens to be historic. It has to do with deals with the history of HBCUs, but also the tradition of Black kids coming out of HBCUs, taking a leadership role and be and advancing the cause of civil rights in this country.
My answer to that is, you know, one of the most remarkable waves of protest in the history of the United States was the sit-in movement that emerged in the spring of 1960. So, you know, February 1st, Greensboro, obviously, and then within the next 4 or 5 months, 50,000 people have sat in all over the South. And Chapel Hill, the Chapel Hill Nine was right in line with that movement. You know, it was just several weeks later that the Chapel Hill Nine launched their sit-in movement in late February of 1960. So they were very much a part of that. I think where they were a bit different was they were so young. You know, a lot of the sit-in folks were college students. You know, college students, for a number of reasons, can participate in activism in ways that they might not be able to if they're in their hometown, where their parents have to worry about jobs and where people know where their family lives and everything else. You know, but boy, these folks, they were doing it in their hometown. And they were 16, 17 years old. You know, they were so young. And I think that's one of the most remarkable things about the civil rights movement here in Chapel Hill. I've also been told that I could ask Mr. Dennis a question, if that's okay. And Mr. Dennis, I would just love to know your reaction in general to the wave of protests that we saw last summer. I've never seen anything like that in my lifetime. Just anything you want to share about, you know, how you felt when you were watching that on TV or participating in it yourself. And, you know, are you optimistic about changes coming to our country?
Yeah, I thought that I was extremely excited about the Black Lives Matter movement. Reminded me so much of when I was young, when I was that age. I mean, I got involved in the civil rights movement. I was at the age of 20. And to see this reaction, I mean, and the interaction of people across the country, and they were acting, which made it so really great, is it reminded me of the 60s too. If something happened in Seattle, Washington, I mean, people would begin to move in Atlanta, Georgia, you know. So it was a very reactant to an action that happened. So that to me was talking about coming together. It had to remind me of this whole thing. I was talking about the extended family pieces and feeling for each other is and bring a togetherness that I had not seen in a long time. So I also feel that this, what I'm seeing here is which is very encouraging, is young people really beginning to raise the right questions. I mean, young people begin to talk about the future. Young people decide that this is not the way I want to live. This is not the kind of country I want to have. You know, so things got to change. So I think that they're moving. That's the reason why. I mean, white America, on the racist side of white America here is scared of this. This is what they're afraid of, to see this kind of movement. So the question, how do you stop this? And it seems as if they can't stop it. I mean, is it on a roll? So I'm very much encouraged about this, Ed, and what we need to talk about doing is how do we help the young people and put a floor beneath them and to strengthen them so they don't stop like some of us did in the 60s and whatever you have is get discouraged and something. So we need to talk about how you build a floor beneath them is because one of the things that this stress and what the young people are going through and psychologically and everything else is, people don't understand this is. I know when I was coming up in the civil rights movement, I didn't have any idea what PTSD was all about. So everybody talks about the fact that you should not stay in this kind of stress and stuff like this more than 6 months or so. It's like a war. Well, most of us is, I know myself is, I was in that for 5 years with no rest, you know? I mean, and it had, I mean, I you know, I've got my wounds whereby from being beaten and other people in the civil rights movement had, But people don't understand is the psychological toll that it took them. So our young people today needs to be have the protection around this stuff is what's coming is. And because part of the problem is in terms of our communities and well, I don't call it communities because they've taken away our communities. The urban renewal stuff is we don't have the village anymore. It takes a village to raise a child. We don't have our villages anymore. So how do you take them back and everything else? But psychologically is how young people is dealing with how you deal with the promise and the understanding that what they now see used to be communities, our escape. That's not the way it was. I mean, our history, we should be able to enjoy this beginning of the program to talk about this history. But the more important in the history is we had our own grocery stores and stuff. We had an economic base. When anybody say Black community never have an economic base, that's a lie, you know? You know, it was built a little bit different, but we had an economic base. And one of the things they did after 1964 civil rights was to do work to try to destroy that, which they were very successful in doing it, at peace. So really and truly is in terms of what's happening now, people are talking about economic development. They're talking about not just getting registered to vote but how do you use that power to make the kind of change that is necessary? You know, how do you begin to build and rebuild communities and stuff is? So to me is I'm very excited about what's going on. I mean, about the changes and young people and the elders need to begin to try to give the support to young people today, just as the elders, when I was in the civil rights movement, you know, gave support to us. Because it had not been for the elders, they had not for this extended family pieces where they took us in and they fed us, they hid us from the races and the Ku Klux Klan, you know, and they protected us. I mean, you had groups like the Deacons for Defense, you had people like individuals like the C.O. Chins and others who actually protected us and so what we need to deal with as adults to figure out how do we give support to our young people, you know, that they need is financial support or whatever they have is, but I'm extremely excited about what's happening in this country is, and I think this is what is necessary. Hats off to the young people.
I just want to echo that. I think that a lot of people on different news stations and in casual conversation often dismiss young people today with a phrase like woke or millennials or whatever. And they are really underestimating them because I work with young people every day. And these folks have another thing coming if they think these young people are a group to be taken lightly.
Mr. Dennis, I have one last question for you. And this may be difficult, but your transformational eulogy at James Shaney's funeral spoke to the frustration and exhaustion of having to continue to see Black people killed for freedom. This was 1964, and we are still seeing Black people being undervalued and are experiencing the same frustration and exhaustion. Would you please share a little bit about that and what has your over 60 years in the movement taught you that we can hold on to in this difficult moment?
Yeah, I think that, let me explain this, what happened on that particular night is because it was not prepared. I had my experience of had things that happened in my life. So a few weeks prior to the eulogy and the finding of the bodies of Cheney Goodman Swernham, they're missing it. I had gone to Atlantic City, New Jersey to try to find housing for the Freedom Democratic Party from Mississippi, our group, because we were doing the challenge and the Democratic Convention was gonna be held in Atlantic City. And I was trying to find housing, secure some housing rather. So one of my good friends, I called him up in New York and he said, why don't you stop here in New York before you go back? I said, man, I got to get back because we got all these kids coming in. We had 1,000 kids coming in a 1,000 kids in Mississippi preparing to do this work that we did. I need to get back there. He said, oh, take a couple of days off, man. I mean, come on. So I went to New York to visit. And he lived around 110th and 5th Avenue. And it was actually his name was David Baldwin, James Baldwin's brother, who was a good friend of mine. So I'm there. And so we laughing and talking and stuff like that. We hear sirens and stuff like this as we go outside. Make a long story short, we walk down to Harlem at 125th. All of a sudden is we're in the middle of the Harlem riots. All right. So for 2 days, 2.5 days, I'm in the streets in Harlem, in the middle of the Harlem riots. So on the last day I was there is a little kid was darted across the street in front of us is, and the cops unloaded on him, shot him right down in the streets there. So David goes over to comfort the kid is, the cops come up to him, cop put a gun to his head and say, nigga, get up or I'll blow your brains out. So David said, you just did. So there's this confrontation there is. I'm standing there like, you know, what do you do? Nothing do. Another black cop comes up, make the white cop put his gun down and told us to leave. And this time is the ambulance coming. I don't know what happened to the kid. I don't know if the kid survived or not. So 3 weeks later, I'm going to do the eulogy. So all of this is up into me. You know, because I was with Meg Evers an hour and a half before he was killed. He's one of my best friends. I was with Chaney Goodman Swerman less than 24 hours before they were killed. So I've got people, you know, dying around me. And so I'm there, and when I'm getting ready to talk, I've been asked by Jim Farmer and others is, because the country was, you know, really exploding all over the places. The riots were happening across the country. And so they didn't want to, so I said, okay. But when I got up there on the stages and I looked out there, I saw Ben Chaney and I saw this kid and I saw bodies, I saw, you know. And so I just exploded. At that particular time, no one could convince me at all is that nonviolence was a way to deal with this. I had flipped, you know. And it took a little while for me to get my head back together is. But I know you can't win this war on a violent war at this time is, you know. But something has to happen whereby this country is becoming much more violent than it ever has been before. I mean, I now live in South Carolina, and they're talking about open gun laws whereby you can walk down the street like you did in the Wild Wild West. In other places, they're doing the same thing. And our black kids, when I look at these young faces, yours and others, because it's not just like black males. I was talking to a high school student the other day, and well, a little bit long, not just the other day, but right after Trayvon Martin, let me put it back exact. And we were talking about what can be done, what should be done about this. And this high school student came up and he said, Mr. Dennis, it's enough for me. When I get up in the morning to make it from home, school, and back and stay alive. So what do we do about it? I don't know, we have to try to change the laws, maybe whatever we gotta do is, but we gotta do something. So when I see young people today out there and struggling like you, we gotta do something. Cause we are dying. And so the protests that the kids are doing and bringing attention to this is, it's gotta happen, they're doing it. And they have to try as much as possible to be nonviolent. That's why they're being infiltrated. So you have to be careful. They did it to us in the civil rights movement, infiltrated to make it seem as we violent or whatever it is, pieces. But we gotta begin to talk about how do we come together as a people, supporting our young people to make the change necessary. Because our lives depend on it.
That was powerful. Thank you, Mr. Dennis and Professor Sturkey, Natasha, Joya, and Derek. You all did an amazing job. Let's take that in for a moment. Thank you. So next, I'd like to welcome Chapel Hill Poet Laureate C.J. Suit, who will deliver a special tribute to Bayard Rustin. C.J. is a performance poet, arts educator, and community organizer from Chapel Hill, North Carolina, whose work is rooted in storytelling and social justice. He co-directed, produced, and starred in a historical reenactment of the 1947 Freedom Rides. He is committed to speaking truth to power and aims to be a bridge for communities who can't always see themselves in each other. CJ, welcome.
Hello, hello, everyone. Just honored to be in the room and share space with Elder Dennis and Professor Sturkey. I won't be before you all very long. I just want to share a little tribute to Bayard Rustin. As Fair said, I did do a historical reenactment right at Hargraves in which we segregated the audience and had George Hauser, a 1947 Fellowship of Reconciliation Freedom Riser, down for that event. And that was just an honor to be a part of. And I learned so much, as I have learned tonight, about just the amount of history that Chapel Hill holds. So much that I didn't learn in the Chapel Hill, Carroll City School system was taught to me in the space of doing this performance and sitting with at the feet of elders who were educating me on where I was. And so I just want to share a little piece in honor of Bayard Rustin here for you all, and feel free to make noise wherever you at. I'll feel that energy over here where I am behind my screen. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around. I'm gonna keep on walking, keep on talking, marching to the freedom land. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around. I'm gonna keep on walking, keep on talking, marching to the freedom land. And so I woke up this morning with my mind stayed on freedom. I woke up this morning with my mind stayed on freedom. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Bayard. Hallelujah. 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 Bayard Rustin. He was Black, a planner, an organizer, a poet, a Quaker whose mentor, A.J. Musty, knew that if we don't start with peace, we won't end with peace. He was an angelic troublemaker. You know, that John Lewis good trouble. Wanted no one to be brutalized, believed a radical revolution would come if we all worked together, all races, all peoples. He was a tennis player, a football player who would knock you down and offer you a poem as you got up, an activist who said our power is in our ability to make things unworkable by tucking our bodies in places so that the wheels of racism, of homophobia, of sexism, and classism don't turn. He was a singer, a public speaker, a war objector who believed that sometimes we deal in matters of economics and in that way, protest is no substitute for the ballot box. A creative, an older brother to Dr. King, an organizer of the March on Washington, a gay man shamed within the movement and without for the way he chose to love. So he chose to play the background so we could live in the open now. An organizing mind, unmatched in his generation, got over a quarter of a million people to the March on Washington without a Google Drive. No email, just synapses firing freedom, actualizing a dream, able to see the mountaintop from the valley. Speaking of the valley, or rather the hill in the valley. 74 years ago, a bus rolled through this town on the corner of Rosemary and Columbia, stopped after the law had been passed that colored folk don't have to ride Jim Crow. The Fellowship of Reconciliation chose to get confirmation for the legislation, make sure the law was enforced as they toured 7 states in a month, riding buses in places it was legal to when they came upon this lovely little college town. They end up serving time on the chain gang. Bayard wrote a reflection of his time in an article called 22 Days on the Chain Gang. This reflection led to the discontinuing of that practice in North Carolina. He is proof that not only the story matters, but the sharing of it, doing something about it, that silence is where the violence lives and persists, that we must choose our battles so our children don't have to fight the same ones. And so today, I woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Bayard. I woke up this morning with my mind stayed on freedom. I woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Bayard. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you all so much. Thank you, thank you.
Yes, yes, yes. Thank you, CJ. Thank you. Yes, I see some snaps in the chat. Thank you. We look forward to hearing more from you, CJ, in our next panel discussion, which will round out this evening's program. And our second panel will be moderated by Orange County Commissioner Renee Price. OCCRC was formed by Commissioner Price and James Williams in the fall of 2018. As commissioner, she serves on various local and regional boards. Commissioner Price has been instrumental in making Juneteenth a county paid holiday and successfully introduced a resolution supporting reparations for descendants of enslaved African Americans. Commissioner Price, it's all yours.
Thank you, Paris, and many thanks to Mr. Dennis and all the young people, and of course, Professor Sturkey and my friend, Professor Emeritus Freddie Parker. Before we begin this next panel, I do want to report that last night on the anniversary of the first Freedom Ride, that the Orange County Board of County Commissioners did pass a proclamation proclaiming the month of May 2021 as Freedom Riders Month in Orange County. And I must say that as I was writing that proclamation, I thought about Bayard Rustin and wondered whatever happened beyond the fact that he had to serve time on the chain gang. So I petitioned our board, and I will be working with Annette Moore to determine whether we need to authorize an apology or seek a pardon for a conviction that certainly was unnecessary and unwarranted. So for our next panel, we are joined by local Orange County activists and artivists. We have with us this evening, Braxton Fushi, who in 1960 walked into the Carolina drug store, then a store and a lunch counter, and requested to be served. He would later become the first African-American to be elected to the Carrboro Board of Aldermen. Braxton is a recipient of the Charles M. Jones Social Justice Award and a recipient of the NAACP Citizenship Award. We also have Jerdine Alston. While a teenager, beginning her studies at North Carolina Central University, she began participating in demonstrations and sit-ins at segregated local establishments. Over the years, she has been arrested several times for her courage to speak out against racism. We also have Latandra Strong, founder of Hate-Free Schools. And in founding that organization, she led the effort to remove and ban Confederate flags and symbols from Orange County schools. And that was within recent years. and CJ Suit, whom you just heard. I had the same introduction for him as Paris did. So I will just say again, he is our wonderful Chapel Hill Poet Laureate, a performance poet and arts educator. And just love having you back with us. And Cortland Gilliam, also co-founder of Yet and Still Productions. He currently is a doctoral student at UNC Chapel Hill and also a poet and educator. His doctoral research investigates the intersections between cultures of school discipline, civics, and citizenship education, discourse, and youth activism. So we've just heard a very powerful story about our history. And so each of you I know is a legend or a legend in the making, having paved the way and still paving the way to equality and freedom, like the women and men of the Freedom Rides. The Freedom Riders certainly influenced and changed the landscape of race relations in America. So depending on when you were born, maybe before 1951 or after 1951, what were your thoughts and actions when you heard the news of the Freedom Rides and the Freedom Riders? So to our veterans, we'll hear from you first, and then to our younger members, how did you learn about the Freedom Rides? And when you became aware, what thoughts went through your mind? So let's begin with the Honorable Braxton Fushi.
Thank you, Renee. I was working at the time that the Freedom Riders came through Chapel Hill. For you non-Chapel Hillians, the bus station was on Franklin Street, where the Franklin Street Hotel is now, what's under a new name. Right down from that was Clarence's Bar and Grill. And that's where most of our opponents were. And there were four arrests that day. And the word spread quickly, very quickly among all of us in town. But I gotta give you a little background since I wasn't there, but how this whole incident started the movement started in Chapel Hill. It started 3 weeks after the Greensboro Four. We didn't know anything about civil disobedience, so SNCC came down from Raleigh and at St. Joseph Church on Rosemary, they taught us the ropes. And from there, we proceeded to the streets. It was basically a young person's movement. We had some old heads in there, the Charlie Joneses, who had been in many fights in his lifetime to help guide us, Vivian Fushi. And I would be remiss if I didn't say James Britton, Fred Battle, David Mason, just to name a few. And we all came from three different neighborhoods around town. The Northside neighborhood was called Pottersville, then Carborough, and another era concentration of Black folk were Tin Top. And so from those areas, the most famous place that the young people met and discussed our strategies was at the Rock in front of Mrs. Patterson's house over in Northside, because most of us were Northside residents. All young, starting ages from, I would say, from 9 to 18 at the time. And we had a lot of older people in their 40s and 50s that looked after us. And so from that movement, it just grew and grew. We were trained at St. Joseph. We came across the street to go met Long Meadow Farms, who had a restaurant there. We moved down to Colonial Drug. And one reason we target Colonial Drug and the Dairy Bar was because the church sit in a vacant parking lot right across from Colonial Drug. And so after Sunday school, all of us would go over and buy our wares, little snacks and stuff after Sunday school, and could never sit down. And that's why our main target was Colonial Drug.
I should know this by now. So evidently, Mrs. Alston must be having technical difficulties, couldn't get on. So we'll go on to Latondra.
Hi. I was first learned of the Freedom Riders and as a young child. I was born with a mother who was really engaged. I was born to a mother who was really engaged with the civil rights movement. And if she did nothing for me, it was to remind me of the cost that was paid for what was supposed to be the post-racial upbringing. And so we were integration had already happened. So I always went to integrated schools. And this was supposed to be the promise of the civil rights movement. And my mother wanted to ensure that I knew that that didn't happen without, in some cases, blood, sweat, and tears. And that people sacrifice tremendously for my freedoms. And I was really struck by Professor Starkey's saying about how short a time it was since these changes had occurred. And just to give a reference for you that I like to share, in my family, I was born right after the civil rights movement was passed. And so, my daughter and my son is the first generation to be born with freedom, with full liberation in America. And so that's something to think about. That's something to think about how you might be impacted knowing that things like a cup of water, you know, was paid with the cost of blood. And I was recently reminded when I was doing the work in Orange County, a white woman came up to me and said, I was at a dinner and she said, "Did you realize that the only reason that you're here is because a law was passed?" And for Black people, we don't have to be reminded. We don't have to be reminded at all that laws had to be passed in order for us to recognize the humanity of brothers and sisters in this country. And so that is the fuel that leads me and guides me routinely. So thank you for this wonderful event.
Okay, Cortland.
First, I want to say it's a privilege to be here and in the company, in such great company. And to learn from everyone in this space. So for me, I think I didn't really come to, I think, fully learn about the Freedom Rides probably until I reached college and I started to kind of do some research independently and do some research on my own. And I say I didn't learn of the Freedom Rides until then, because even though I might have The topic of the Freedom Rides probably came up when I was in high school. In U.S. history, I was not taught, as Ms. Strong said, the cost, right? I was not taught about the larger significance of the rides, everything that went into making that, into the production that was the rides, and just the groundswell of youth activism and organizing that made it possible. That was not communicated to me in high school, even though we might have talked about the Freedom Rides happened in the summer of 60, 61, right? So even though that was topically covered, I didn't really have a sense of what it meant. And it and how it made a way for me to even, you know, be at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. So it came later in life for me. And I think that is something that a lot of people can identify with, a lot of Black students in particular. I'm curious, you know, as to, you know, the youth who were presenting in the previous panel, you know, the difference between my, you know, I'm only maybe a generation separated from them, but my educational experiences in K-12 and perhaps the ones that they've had and whether or not those gaps still remain. But yeah, for me, it came much later. And I think the other, just to wrap up this part of it, the thing that crossed my mind when I did learn kind of the large significance and of the movement and of some of the individual actors in the Freedom Rides movement is something that's kind of been touched on already, but just kind of in all of the age of the people participating. And the idea that, you know, someone younger than me, you know, when I was an undergrad, someone younger than me had a significant role in organizing something like that and bringing that to fruition, was giving of themselves and of their time, putting their bodies on the line to travel the country and to seek voting rights for Black Americans. So I think the age is something that I always return to, and I think that reflects some of Dr. Sturkey's comments previously. About how frequently we underestimate, you know, the power of youth and the ideas of youth, the way they think and the way that they see the world and what they're willing to kind of commit and put forth to bring that vision into reality. So that's some of my initial reflections when I learned about the rise.
Okay. And CJ, well, we've already listened to your performance, but nonetheless, when did you learn about the Freedom Riders? When did you become aware, and what were the thoughts?
For sure. So I first learned about the Freedom Rides. I watched this series that folks might be familiar with called Eyes on the Prize in school, and I'm a Chapel Hill Colorado City Schools kid. And so there was a lot of like sort of post-racial conscious vibes. So we like went through the civil rights movement, but it was sort of couched in this idea that was something that happened like over there back then, and that we are living in integrated sort of classrooms because we've moved past that, and here we are in this liberal bubble and everybody is together now. And so I learned about it the 61 rides, and it wasn't until I was older and working with a historian here, Yanni Chapman, who passed some years past, and when I learned about the 1947 Freedom Rides, and then did this production with an organization called United with the North Side Community Now, which was led by Della Pollock and Reverend Harrison at St. Joseph's Church in Chapel Hill. And I think what came to me was like, what, this happened here, right? Like, and I just had this sort of all of a sudden feeling of like, whoa, wait a second. Like, again, this feeling of that happened back then over there. And I just think like the more I like dug into it was just like, what? And they were arrested and what? They got sentenced to time on the chain gang and Bayard Rustin, what? Like, who organized the March on Washington? And it just like led me down sort of this rabbit hole of wanting to understand like the history and the real, the herstory, the all the things of this place that I'm in. And I, you know, I think part of me felt upset that it had been kept from me, because it felt like there was some intentionality in keeping it from me. And I think also I've always been a spacious, forgiving person in my Christian upbringing. So I was just like, and it's being kept from y'all, like looking at the adults in my life. And so I felt really like on this sort of mission to figure out who is doing the keeping and why is it being kept? Because we are like just as rich a civil rights area in the country as Selma, right? As Montgomery. Like when we start to really dig in the crates of what happened here as an artist, like George Moses Horton and his legacy and all the things that have happened on this land in this place. And so, I think that was my initial reaction in the story of coming to that.
Okay.
And I'm gonna now go to our two artivists that are with us. Next question is, through the arts, we define who we are as a people. And for 400 plus years, Black people have expressed our emotions, and we've related our story through singing, poetry, music, theater, visual arts, and even more. What role does your art or art form play in the 21st century demand for liberty and justice for all? Mm. So that goes to Cortland and CJ.
Okay. I was like, let our poet laureate take it. So just briefly to give people background about my art, and kind of, I'm in part here representation of a project called Black Out Loud. This was a project that was put on and kind of co-curated by myself and my co-facilitator, co-creator, Jerry Wilson, who's another doctoral student at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, another doc student in education like myself, who unfortunately couldn't be here with us today. But what this project was, Black Out Loud, it was a pop-up arts exhibition that we put on campus in partnership with the Center for the Study of the American South and the great people there doing awesome work there around reimagining the South, or, you know, how do we turn attention to narratives of the South and erasures within the larger narrative of the South? So who's been left out of that construction of the narrative of Southern history or the American South, right? But in partnership with them, we put on this event called Black Out Loud, which was an art exhibition that aimed at highlighting the beauty and the heterogeneity of Blackness, specifically within the context of this historically white public university town in the American South. And so briefly, what we did with this art exhibition was we sent out an open call to the larger campus, to the larger community, and we were seeking Black artists to submit art of various, you know, types, you know, genres, mediums, that revolved around this theme of representations of Blackness within this town. And so essentially, you know, what did being Black mean to them, and how do they want to express that? And what we got back was some amazing work from some undergraduate students. We had one professional school student, a nursing student. We had a couple of alumni as well submit projects. And, you know, we received everything from, you know, visual art, you know, paintings and sketchwork, photography, some documentary work, and some sculpture, and a gang of poets also submitted, which was great. Being a poet myself, I was happy to have the performance artists present. And what we did is we put on a night of a gallery walk and a performance block, and we just had a showing of Blackness. And we took up space on the University of North Carolina to dedicate it towards the telling and the expressing of these Black lived experiences. And it was a phenomenal night. I could go on and on about that night, but keeping to the question, what I learned through that experience and the putting on of that project, as it relates to kind of the role, or what I view as the role of art and the way that my art and that project kind of played in our larger demand for liberty and justice, was, you know, a couple of things. One, just making the point that, you know, being Black publicly and unapologetically isn't itself resistance, isn't itself a political action. And I think there are risks that come with that. And there are reasons that we have, you know, felt safe in, you know, out of the public eye in private spaces. And there's particular work that happens there too, out of the public eye. And there's work that's generative there. There's something about keeping certain stories for ourselves. I hear that. But there's also work that comes with just being Black open and publicly and unapologetically. So that's one thing that we did with that event. And that was reflected in the title of Black Out Loud, right? That was our intention. And in the process of putting on the show, we converted essentially the Center for the Study of the American South into our gallery. So we even, you know, thanks to the kind folks there, they allowed us to take over their office spaces, you know, push desks back, you know what I mean, cover up the walls. And we essentially put on this, we blacked up the space, we put on this Black showing. So that was one part about the connection between that. And the second is that, which was touched on in the previous panel, was the importance of this, of community building. So not only was this an opportunity for students to showcase their art many of whom were showcasing for the first time and stepping into this role as a creative. It wasn't just an opportunity for that, it was bringing Black students on campus together. And these are students who may have felt isolated on the larger University of North Carolina campus. And even in Black spaces, they may have felt isolated as opposed to in white spaces on campus as well. So it was bringing these Black creatives together for this larger work of storytelling and painting the mosaic of Blackness rather than a broad stroke of what Blackness means for them in Chapel Hill. So there's that dual significance of that community building part, as well as the larger message of just, you know, being unapologetically yourself in public space.
Absolutely. And particularly, you know, when we've gone in different directions, it's important to bring it back in as a community. PJ, your art.
Sorry.
You're on mute.
I'm unmuted now. My cat is going crazy in here. Yeah, so I think for me, the only thing I would add to that as a poet, I think that in thinking about Bayard Rustin and thinking about being a poet and as an artist and a bridger of worlds in a lot of ways, right, is I think that a big piece of what is important is having people understand that, like, one, I'm a Black artist. I think I would second everything that, like, Courtland has said, and also that I'm here too, right? I think that because I bring my voice to, like, have people understand that no matter what you see on the visitor brochure, no matter what you see in the Chapel Hill magazine, no matter what you see on the brochures that happen to come out of university, no matter how much Carolina blue we paint things, that Blackness is here, right? You know, I still, and particularly, I grew up outside the rural buffer in Chapel Hill. I grew up in the country parts of Chapel Hill. I still got folks who sound like they from deep, deep down south who grew up in Chapel Hill, who still cut trees and still, like, dig ditches and still do that type of work right here. And understanding that that is also Chapel Hill. I remember growing up here and my relatives from the eastern part of the state thought that we were wealthy because we lived in Chapel Hill, when the fact was that I didn't have running water for the first, like, 5 or 7 years in my house with a Chapel Hill address. Ooh. And so in a lot of ways, like, I think that's what I bring in terms of, and that's what I bring and that's what I show up with as an artist, is having people really understand that there is more than one story that is happening here. And also that, as Dr. King says, our, like, liberation is inextricably linked. That when I, as a Black person, win, you win too. Like, I was thinking about a lot, like, what happened after we started questioning names and stuff after the movement for Black Lives last year, and all of a sudden we were changing things. Aunt Jemima came off the thing finally, right? But then I went to the grocery store and I looked at a pack of what other people would know, what my folks would know as oodles and noodles, but ramen noodles, right? And they got a blue pack, right? They got a blue pack that used to be the Oriental flavor, which was always problematic, that they have now switched to the soy sauce flavor, right? Which is like accurate to what it was, right? So in many ways, when we start to, like, when Black folks start to win, right? As an artist, what I bring through storytelling, through bridge building, through the poem and through art, which can be an offering, right? And can be presented and offered to people as an offering in a lot of ways, is an understanding that if we win, if we get this right, then we all win together. When Black people win, everybody wins, right? Exactly. Poor whites win, brown folks win. I mean, I could go on for a long time, but you know.
Yes.
That's, yeah. Thank you.
All right, and to our activists, Latondra and Braxton. So you've lived, you know, this civil rights movement, you've been a part of it, and you've had a chance to look back, Braxton maybe a little bit further than Latondra, but how does the activism of today, do you think, differ from the activism of yesteryear as we all endeavor to dismantle racism?
I don't think it's changed that much.
Okay.
Because I'm always in your face. I mean, if you got something to say, you got to say it, and don't try to dress it up. just put it out there. That's what I see in the younger folks now. I look at CJ, you know, he just tells it like it is.
Okay. Latondra? Sorry about that. So I just want to let you know that I'm coming off of a week of being in Elizabeth City. And I have watched two very young people who are very active in activism just get arrested in Graham. And so to Braxton's comment, it hasn't changed a lot. And then it has changed. So I think that the stops in activism that have occurred after what we thought was a change, a positive change, a change towards the positive, have been costly. I think that we now look at a Stacey Abrams and everybody is rushing to figure out what she did when we should have been doing that all along, you know? We shouldn't be rushing to figure out what she did. We should know, because our people have always created the thing out of the nothing. We should have already known, and we shouldn't be rushing. We have forgotten in some ways how important it is to be very grassroots, very taking care of our community, very your pain is my pain, because in some ways we as a community, some of us have moved further away from this segregation. We haven't, although we aren't fully integrated, we are seeing some people being able to benefit from some of the integration and not think this is their story. The other part that I am encouraged by, at least in this area, is and especially looking at the Freedom Riders, is white people, you don't get a pass because it ain't your story. And the Freedom Riders that were there working just as hard as the Black folk that were there, it is also your responsibility to work just as hard. Because as I do work in education, we talk a lot about the deficit in achievement for Black folks in this area, and the gap, and how Black folks aren't doing well. But what we don't talk about is how the deficit in achievement for white folks is also going down. And so we have to do this work together. We have to. I love the young folks because, you know, they imagine a world that is so much nicer and so much better. And so they're constantly pushing the envelope, and we have to secure the future for our children. And I'm happy that we had a bump in activism in the summer, but quickly after that, we went back to, you know, we can vote and be done with it, and we don't have to push and we don't have to pressure. And so I would encourage folks to understand that this can't happen with only a few of us doing the work. We all have to be doing the work. And we need to really, really, really think about where we are when education is not afforded to all. When people are dying because of their skin, we have to really think about where we are as humans, that we can't see the suffering in our community, that Black people are leaving Chapel Hill and Orange County by the droves because there is no affordable housing, and there is no space for us here. And so I applaud the work of the artists, because I have always felt like activism and artivism are like, they're the two tools that make this possible. Because while I might say something harshly, CJ can present it in a way that it's more acceptable. So I think it goes in hand in hand. Thank you. I've gotten a message that we can take questions and questions from the audience using the Q&A feature as opposed to the chat, I guess. Or I suppose if you want to use the chat, that's fine as well. And you can pose to the audience, you may pose questions to these four panelists as well as Mr. Dennis. And while people are putting their questions in, I had one more question, and I think you would agree. And just very, very briefly, because I said questions will be coming in. For me, anyway, I see the freedom struggle, the civil rights movement, the fight for voting rights, the Poor People's Campaign, and now these protests for justice within a criminal justice system as part of a continuum. I've often heard that, you know, the civil rights movement ended back in 1960-something, but I disagree with that. So do you agree or disagree? And where do we go from here? And just briefly, where do we go from here?
That's a good question, Renee. We have to make a seat at the table. Because if you're not at the table, we are going to be left out.
Okay.
That means education, that means voter registration, that means the thousands of meetings that you and I go to. you got to be, people ask me all the time, when are you going to stop? I can't stop. There's no stopping. You got to keep pushing. Because there's always somebody over your shoulder want to put their foot on your neck. And you got to let them know it's not acceptable.
Absolutely. So we do have a question. How can more of this important history, ongoing struggle, be ensured in the curriculum for young people in our community? We'll unmute with Andrea.
I just want this because, you know, there is currently at the state level a task force called the Truth Task Force, brought on by the Lieutenant Governor. And the hope is to make this not a part of the curriculum in North Carolina. Like, there is a real effort to make legislation that would restrict what's being told in our schools about the civil rights movement. And so it is very important that you join folks who are pushing. Hate-Free Schools is certainly one of those organizations that's pushing for them to disband the Truth and Task Force, and hope that we're watching the legislation daily, so that if a bill presents itself, that we would be advocating for it to be stricken down.
I would like to try to respond to that a little bit. I think that we need to take it on ourselves to teach our children ourselves. We cannot depend upon an education system run by the enemy. It's we allow the enemy to teach our children. You know, they gonna win the war. So one of the things that's very interesting to me is looking at the history, is that public education was actually started by freed slaves. Mm-hmm. Not why people think, well, I want to cause a bleed the free slaves. And nobody understands yet truly about how did they begin to have so many Blacks who were able to teach our kids. I mean, you had over 400 schools within a couple year period times after Reconstruction, but from South Carolina moving all the way into New Orleans. And one of the things that's very interesting is that they're insisting in the beginning is, you know, that the carpetbaggers themselves were not the ones to begin to teach their kids to get into the schools, but they wanted to teach themselves because they felt that their kids need to understand their own culture first, which is a very amazing thing. You look at that history. But we need to begin to talk about how we need to look at our elders and talk to our elders. When my mom died, I looked at the Bible. And she had my grandmother's Bible, she had her Bible. On those pages, printed whatever it is, was a lot of history about my family. So we get into ourselves is and begin to talk and have discussions, even with our family, we learn a lot about our past, our history, and what happened there. But we need to figure out ourselves is how to teach our children and learn more about ourselves. And that's the change of curriculum. That to me has to be the new curriculum.
Yeah. Mr. Dennis, while you're there at the mic, what was your training for the Freedom Rides? And what did your parents know, or did they know what you were doing?
My training is, I started, when I went to, I went to Southern University Lab School. I didn't want to really have anything to do with the civil rights movement because I was the first person in my family to graduate from high school. So when I got going to colleges, I wanted to be an electrical engineer, and that was my way out of this whole thing of poverty and segregation. I thought is I'd make me some money. And we talk about fate, you know, and why God sort of intervenes in your life. So I really was one day I was walking across the campuses and I saw a crowd of young people under the flagpole at Dillard University's. And there was a young lady talking to them about civil rights and stuff. And I'm like, okay, you know, let me go see what she's talking about. Only because I wanted to have a date with her. So I was trying to get a date with her and she talked me into going to a core meeting in New Orleans at Reverend A.L. Davis' church, Mount Zion Baptist Church is. And that's how it got started, you know? And so my getting involved with the movement, I was involved. And so finally, I didn't want to get involved in the demonstration stuff is I followed her because she told me if I had to date, she's going to go out with me, I have to be a man and stand up. So I got to go on a demonstration. So I go on a demonstration is, and I get arrested by accident. Right? So I end up in jail. And then that follows the fact is on the Freedom Ride, when the buses were burned in Birmingham and Alabama, Anderson, Alabama, and the people beat in Birmingham. We were involved in the core group in New Orleans, Aretha Castle Haley, and her sister was Doris, who I was chasing. And so they wanted to go on, you had at that time is about the moratorium on the Freedom Rides. And this is an important piece here because one end you had Diane Nash and them who wanted to continue the ride, John Lewis and others. But on another end, which is lost in history, it's one of the reasons why we had to begin to tell our own history, is the work of a lady by the name of Aretha Castle Haley, who was pushing for, and New Orleans Corps was pushing to continue the ride also. So there's a group of us out of New Orleans said, we're gonna join, meet them up in Montgomery, Alabama. And so they decided to do that, not me. But Doris says, you gotta come with me if you want a date. And she's still holding out that hook. 6 months has gone by and I'm still not having a date with her. And so I end up in Montgomery, Alabama. And there's a riot, that buildings are burning, everything else. We had Reverend Harris's, Dr. Harris's house. This is where my change in my life was. I talk about fate. So I'm in this meeting with all the people I read about. You got Diane Nash, you got Martin Luther King is, you got C.T. Vivian, you know, Y.T. Walker, you got them all there. And they're debating between the young people and the adults, elders, about whether the ride should continue. And the young people were saying, we've got to continue this ride. I'm sitting there saying, Lord, how am I gonna get back to school? Because to answer your other questions, my mama don't even know where I am, okay? She had no idea that I'm there. So this is where God stepped in. Somewhere in that, always religious, I hear this voice, and I've asked people over and over again, who said this? And nobody says, I don't know what you're talking about, Dave. But the voice in my head says there's not enough space in this room for both God and fear. And for some, I don't know how many of y'all been on the morning bench, you know, the old time churches, we talk about, you know, get that religion going. When it hits you, you know. Something hit me. I never turned back again. So that's how I got in. And by the way is, I never got a date with Doris.
Oh, well, so we're about to wrap up. And I would just leave it to CJ, Cortland, or LaTondra. Did you want to, or even Mr. Dennis, to say, where do we go from here? Did you have any final comments on that? I think for the most part, you've answered that question, but any final remarks on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think I just would like quote Matriarch Mary Church Terrell is to say that we are like lifting as we climb. And so I very much see myself as a part of a continuum. And just because you pause on a step on the ladder doesn't mean that the movements are not connected. And so I definitely see myself connected to all the movements we spoke of here, and just honored to be a part of it and be carrying it forward.
Okay.
And then one thing I'll just add briefly is I always say use what you have and do what you can. I think everybody has different gifts that allow them to contribute to this movement in different ways. And then the rest of it is the action piece. You know what I mean? Are you acting, and are you taking rest and then getting back into that action? Because everybody has something to contribute. And I think with that, there's sacrifice, there's cost, but you still have to act and use what you've been given to contribute.
And Latandra?
I would just say get involved in your local communities, that there's work being done all throughout the communities. And sometimes it's art and sometimes it's challenging. Sometimes it's writing a letter, but there is a place for everyone in the movement to recognize the civil rights of all human beings.
Okay, thank you all. And I will now turn it back over to our mistress of ceremonies, Paris Miller Fushin.
Thank you, Commissioner Price. I'd just like to begin by giving thanks to Mr. David Dennis. This was truly magical. And also thank you to all of this evening's panelists, our interviewers. Thank you, moderator, for being a part of tonight's program. I would also like to give a special thanks to Carolina K-12. We've got Paul Benici behind the scenes. We have Christy Norris as well as the OCCRC Freedom Rides Planning Committee on all of the hard work in putting this program together. And to you, our attendees, thank you for joining us this evening. Accompanying resources and lessons for teachers will be made available after the event. And so I say to you, thank you, good night, forward together, not one step back.
All right.
Excellent.
Thanks, Renee.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Mr.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you for having me. It's been a privilege.
A light at the end of this road.
Thank you.
And I know that there's still a long way to go. As long as my head is high and I walk with pride, go with the strength inside, take every step in stride, no chance will pass me by. Long as I always try, won't let my passions die. And as long as I'm alive, the future belongs to me. Oh, the future belongs to me. And it's gonna be a beautiful thing. The glory days are gone. How will you be remembered? What page will you be on? Will you be someone they reverence with wise words to quote. A paragraph, a page, a chapter, more than a footnote. As simple as the questions asked, the answer I propose is to look beyond the days gone past. To see tomorrow knows that the future belongs to me. Oh, the future. Beautiful thing to see, such a beautiful thing to see. It's gonna be such a beautiful thing to see. The future belongs to me. The future, the future, the future, the future. The future belongs to me.